something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't be long to me. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me
and the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall not die eternally. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. The hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Greetings to you all, and welcome to Para Wesley Methodist Church. I'm not sure that I've ever had quite such a noisy funeral, but I am grateful because not often as a minister, you know, you're used to having a solemn face and so on, but just some funerals, I'm just more likely to lose control than others. So I'm grateful for the laughter that we can celebrate Alan's life as we come together. You know, Alan was unfailingly polite. I don't know what he was like at home. Maybe he was different, but I actually don't think so. He was just always polite. And I don't know if he knew that he was going to have the soldiers of Jesus at his funeral. But I really think it's just such a wonderful send-off. If he was in his coffin here, he would sit up and say, "Oh, good morning, guys. Nice to have you with us." And just carry on. So I really think it's a great way to say goodbye to Alan. But we are going to sing together from your hymn sheet, and it's going to be on the screen as well. And for those at home, we'll be able to watch it on the screen. We're going to sing together, "O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder."
I see the stars.
hope that you watching at home are able to hear the singing, the microphone on the ground. It's great to be able to worship. I want to just let you know that Angela and Ivan are online, Ruth, and they're sending their sympathies. Eugene and Eleanor. Of course, Eugene and Eleanor are the leaders of Alan's Bible study and Ruth's Bible study for many years. Karen from the UK. Patrick Rumble has found his way online and sends his condolences. Dr. Moya sends condolences to Ruth and family. Melanie Schneider, I'm sure that comes from Gloria as well, sends condolences. Is Gloria here? There's Gloria. Wonderful. It's nice to have see the YWA out in force to support Ruth. Who's here? Okay. Melanie, your mom is embarrassing you. And to Jude, from Judith Rodger, sending wishes and hugs from Adelaide, South Australia. Okay, so there they are. And there are other people online. I just don't know who they are. So you will have to find out later because they haven't put messages. So if you are online and you are able to log in and leave a message, I can read it out for Ruth and the family. So please do that. Meanwhile, we are going to pray together. Let us pray. Eternal God, the Lord of life, the conqueror of death, our help in every time of trouble, comfort us who mourn, and give us grace in the presence of death to worship you, that we may have sure hope of eternal life and be enabled to put our whole trust in your goodness and mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I don't know what Ellen's middle name is. No middle name. Because he had a surname as a middle name. There we go. We are met in this solemn moment to commend Alan Rodger into the hands of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father. In the presence of death, Christians have sure ground for hope and confidence, and even for joy, because the Lord Jesus Christ, who shared our human life and death, was raised again triumphant and lives forevermore. In him, his people find eternal life. Let us then, in humble trust, hear the words of Holy Scripture. And I'm going to read to us first from Psalm 23. It's words of comfort from the shepherd, or about the shepherd, perhaps. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And then from Romans chapter 8, and so then if I have perhaps chosen a particular passage for Alan, it'll be this one. I'm going to start from verse 31, but you could probably start a bit earlier if one wanted to. Romans 8 from verse 31. What shall we then say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We have some more people sending in condolences. Simon and Janet in Melbourne. Emily Wall, is that how you say it? Praying for you, she says. And from Lydia, Erasmus, and Vincent. Praying for you, Ruth, as well. We are going to, I think, Grant, you're going to play the PowerPoint as a eulogy. This is put together by the family and Chanel, so I think we're going to do the PowerPoint. Then I'm going to ask Graham if he's going to come forward and sing for us. And then I'm going to say if anybody else would like to say anything about Alan, after Graham has sung, feel free to come. Graham, I think that's your signal, please. There you are. Grateful to Alan for introducing Graham to this congregation so that we can share in his singing. Is there anybody that would like to say a few words about Alan? I know it's hard for the family because they all know they're going to stand up here and cry, so they don't want to say anything. If there's anybody that would like giving you a sort of a going chance. Is there somebody, would you like to come and say something about Alan? Just a few words?
Both started our accounting degree, our accounting careers in 68, and we both did articles and we both worked for auditing firms. And one of the memories was that we both stood along the road when the president opened parliament. We both stood as soldiers along the pavements. It wasn't as the way it is now when you see the Sona address. They had motorbikes, but we stood with our old 303 guns and our bayonets, unscabbarded, And we stood there through the sun for many hours waiting for the president to come past. And on the day we stood, it was very, very hot. And quite a number of guys fainted. And I don't know if Ruth remembers this, but Alan fainted. And he stuck himself in the neck with his bayonet. It affected his hearing. Did you know about that? Yeah. But the memory I have of Alan can be summed up in one word. And if you could think of a word to compliment somebody, it wouldn't be a word that the world would regard as a compliment. But in the language of Jesus, it would be the best compliment. And that is the word servant. Whereas Jesus says those who would be a leader must learn to be the servant of all. And to me, Alan summed up the servant as in Jesus' meaning of the word. He was a true servant of God, and he did so much for everybody, especially in the church, that I think he was a wonderful example of what Jesus expected of us. So my tribute to Alan was, thank you for being such a beautiful servant of God. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I was really hoping to hear from an accountant because we had to have an accountant speaking about Alan. So thank you. Thank you, Stella.
Good morning. Well, I remember Alan. The first time I saw Alan, he was sitting quite close to the back of the church. And I was wondering, who is this chap now? He always sits in front of me and I can't see who he is. So one day I tapped him on the shoulder and I said, hey, who are you? And we got to know each other. And then slowly he got involved in the church. I saw that he was with the men's group. And then, wow, one Sunday, there's Ruth. I thought, where does she come from? And yeah, it took her a while to get here, but he got her here. And she joined our ladies group and we've got to know them. And Alan was pretty involved in the church. He was always doing something, always rushing around, but always had the time to say good morning, hello, and have a chat. And then he'd rush off. And Ruth would be sitting in our Lyle room, a little room off the church here, and waiting and waiting and waiting. And we'd say, are you still waiting, Ruth? And she'd say, yes. She says she's so fed up because he's always waiting. He's always at church. He's always doing something for the church. And I said to her, but that's fantastic. At least it's something for the church. I mean, he could be in the pub. He could be in a lot of other places. So she said, no, she's tired of him now. She thinks he should move out. So I said, well, I said, we've got the loft up here. I said, no one ever goes up there. Maybe he could take his bed there. And she actually agreed. So maybe we must just check and see if Alan has got a bed up there that we didn't know about, just in case he was locked out. But also, I went to Bible study with Ruth and Alan for a while. And believe it or not, Ruth was quiet. Alan did the talking, but Ruth was quiet. She didn't say much. I think she did a lot of talking and spoke all the way home. But it was lovely getting to know them better. yes, and Alan, he had this contagious laugh. He would be talking and then he would laugh and we would all turn around and we'd start laughing. What are we laughing at? I don't know. But Alan had this wonderful laugh. So I think for us, we can say, thank you, Alan, for all you did for our church, for the joy, for the laughter, and behind the scenes, all the hard work, because you never did anything to get praise or thanks. You just did it quietly because you're doing it for God. May we always follow in your footsteps. Thank you.
Thank you, Stella. I think I should give Ruth right of reply. I don't know if Stella and I are going to be allowed to visit Ruth again after that. Does anybody else want to say anything? Grant was saying in the car, as he said, servant, Grant used the word steward. He said, Alan was a steward. We all say all through our lives we must be good stewards of what God has given us. And Alan could look back and say he has been a good steward of all that God gave him. And yes, I think that is a very real compliment to somebody. Okay, gone. There we go. We have online Brian and Susan in Johannesburg. That's Alan's brother, Brian. There we go. And Thomas Rodger, Thomas and Chris in Melbourne. Good to have you. And Joan Bray from just over there. Says hi to Ruth and family. Yeah, as I, Grant, I think I just did something. Fix it. As I was thinking about what to say about Alan, and you know, I didn't feel I needed to explain Alan, because I think that what you saw is what you got with Alan. He was Alan. He was always there. He was always available. He was always nice. When he was ill and in hospital, you know, we have the leaders group, which many of you are on our church leaders group. And I used to watch for the message from Alan to say, thank you, Jenny, for the messages every day. Because then I knew Alan was at least so far okay. But then, you know, the day he passed away, I think it was less than an hour before he passed, that he sent the message saying thank you. So, you know, he was there. It mattered to him. I actually almost wondered if he'd put on an automatic response and if we'd get it again the next day. The only thing is, I know it's so hard to do that with WhatsApp. If he'd ever figured it out, he could have told me how. But I can't find a way. But yeah, Alan was very special. And I was actually reading about how we always intellectualize our feelings. So maybe I'm going to force us to feel our feelings a little bit. I don't know that Alan was particularly musical. In fact, perhaps he was particularly not musical. I know he did not sing in the choir, let's put it that way. But I wanted to take a little bit of music. And so those of you that are used to me doing something a bit different in church, we're going to kind of sing a wail through my little tribute or sermon, if you don't mind. And I've chosen this hymn, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, you know, it is well with my soul." Because I think this is a hymn that would have defined a lot of Alan's life. And that reading that I read, that we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. This idea of being able to overcome all things. This hymn, I'm sure that many of you know, was written by somebody who had, he lost his son when his son was 4 years old. He lost his daughters in a trip across the sea where the ship sank and they were drowned. And he also actually lost his business holdings and everything in the Great Fire of Chicago, when much of the property that he had bought had been burnt down. So he was in a real state. And then when he went across the ocean to join his wife on the other side, as he crossed over the point where the previous ship had sunk, he wrote these words in a hymn. And I happened to be speaking about it at Norwood last week. And I said, you know, to sing these words in the midst of such tragedy, you're either a total fake or you've had a miracle. Because it takes a miracle to be able to transcend that level of sadness and that level of depression. And I believe that Alan lived those miracles day in and day out, that he believed that his God was there. I believe that the man who wrote this hymn, Horatio Spafford, knew about that miracle. And I know that for many of us right now, peace is not something that's kind of right there in our hearts. I know, especially family, when you get to arranging a funeral, you know how everybody's like trying to do this one and trying to do that one, this one wants to do that. Even in the church, Esme was saying, this one's doing this and this one's doing this, and it's all happening, but it's all happening. There's just a little bit of a lack of sometimes of harmony. But God sends us peace. And so I want us, just where we're sitting, Derek is going to play for us. We're just going to sing the first verse in the chorus of "When Peace Like a River."
Oh,
we know that Alan's life wasn't always easy. We can have the next verse up there, Grant. There was a long period when he was retrenched and struggling to make ends meet financially. We know there were various relationship issues. We know that he lost his son. And so Alan's life wasn't always straightforward. For all of us, there were very hard times in his life. But that's really where faith kicks in, isn't it? When you can stick in there even when things are hard. And to know that God is with you and God is holding you up and traveling with you through it all. So though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, we know that Christ sees us, that Jesus sees us wherever we are, and that he gave his blood for our souls. It sounds gory, perhaps if you're younger and you don't understand it, but this idea that he sees our pain and he suffered for us and carries us through it. So let us, and this is a prayer for us, as we think of the example of Alan, we pray for ourselves that God will be this for us. Let's sing this verse in the chorus. That Alan was an accountant, a financial person, and of course that is the way he served this church for many, many years. In fact, I think he's still a signatory on the bank account, so our current financial steward is going to have to try and sort that one out. But you know, he was there to help Ismay, he was so thin, and he would come into the office and go to the bank and sort out all the bits and pieces. And you know, it's good to have a good financial person working in the church. In fact, I think the financial steward in the church is almost more important than the minister. Maybe more important, you know, because the church runs out of money, it's gone. But you know, the very best financial steward is the one that's in church every Sunday. It's the one that is living their faith, that's going to Bible study, that is part of the life of the church. And so Ellen was, and so our current finance steward is as well, so she can know that she follows in Ellen's wonderful footsteps. But again, as we say, when we were online, it was Ellen and Ruth, and Ruth is carrying on. Now I know Ruth is there online at our online services. Before we were online, before COVID, they were in church every Sunday. And when Ruth wasn't well, it didn't always work like that, but they were there. And so this commitment, this faith, it's not just about the hard times, and it's not just about the money and the work, but it's a sense of what God has done for us. And so I believe this was deep in Alan's theology and Alan's belief. The bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but in whole, all of my sin, is nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. And we can feel that now. We don't have to wait until we die. Our sin is carried by Jesus as soon as we bring it to him. And Alan knew it and lived it. Praise the Lord, O my soul. So those of us that believe, we're going to sing this with faith now together as we celebrate the life of Alan.
Thank you.
last verse of so many hymns celebrates the time when we are going to pass away and be with Jesus. And there it says, "O Lord, haste the day when faith shall be sight." And of course we're saying, "Lord, did it have to be so soon for Alan? Couldn't it have been a little bit longer?" But we do know that it's better for him to be with Jesus, that he would not like where he was before he passed on. And so although it is hard, and we really would wish that he hadn't already crossed over, we can celebrate. And we know that whatever he's doing right now, he is full of joy, full of good health, full of strength, and a good and wonderful place. So as we sing this one, I'm going to ask us to stand up. I'm going to ask Derek to give us some volume and some speed on the organ. And we're going to sing this with triumph that Alan has overcome and Jesus has overcome. Volume. As well. Please be seated. I'm going to pray for the family and then go into the prayers from the book. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for Alan and for his life and the celebration of it. But Lord, we want to bring family to you now. These seated in the few rows in the front. And Lord, as we celebrate and laugh together, and it's good to have family together, we also know that there are times of great sadness and great loss. And so, Lord, we want to pray your comfort on each one. We pray especially for Ruth, who is going to know the absence day in and day out, that real gap that Alan's just not there to tell him this thing or to talk to or to ask him to do this or to do that. And, Lord, that you would be there, not taking it away, but just cushioning the grief, just helping her to cope and helping her to bear it. And we pray, Lord, that she can grieve in a healthy way and become strong again as she journeys through this. We know, Lord, that she will never forget Alan, but we pray, Lord, that the memories will be comforting and good. And we pray also for the children and the grandchildren, Alan's brothers and family, Lord, that you would be with each one as they struggle in their own particular way with the loss. We pray, Lord, that you would give them the strength that they need, that you would give them the encouragement that they need, that you would give them the faith that they need, that they would stand firm for you in each and every way, and each and everything. Watch over them, Lord. Keep them strong. Keep them safe. And let them know your presence in a very real way with them. And Lord, we pray also for Alan's friends, which there were many of, and his clients, which there were many of, and his church friends, and so on, Lord, that you would bless each one in a very special way as we mourn the loss of Alan. And so, Lord, we come to say praise and honor, glory and thanks be given to you, Almighty God, our Father, because in your great love for the world, you gave your Son to be our Savior, to live our life, to bear our griefs, and to die our death upon the cross. We praise you because you have brought him back from death with great power and glory, and given him all authority in heaven and on earth. We thank you because he has conquered sin and death for us, and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. We praise you for the great company of the faithful, whom Christ has brought through death to behold your face in glory, who join with us in worship, prayer, and service. For your full, perfect, and sufficient gift of life in Christ, all praise and thanks be given to you forever and ever. Amen. I think Stephen is going to say a few words of thanks and about his dad. So over to Stephen.
what happens when you have to speak at the end.
Sorry. Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. So some of this I wrote down word for word, and then I realized there's not going to be enough space, so I bullet pointed some other stuff, so there's still an opportunity to mess this up. Yeah, I opted for the thank yous because it was supposed to be easier for the emotional side and actually being able to say stuff. So yeah, before I get to the official thank yous, sort of say something. Yeah, let's start off with something funny. So while we were looking for the photos and stuff for these various slideshows and so on, like noticed how chubby my dad was, and I don't seem to recall him being like a chubby person at all. He's never to me looked chubby, but these photos, I suppose they don't lie. So I think it's worth repeating for all of us. We can maybe even repeat it now and say, oh, wow, I don't remember him being so chubby. So let's all say that, come on. Oh, wow, I don't recall him being so chubby. And for those that come to my funeral one day, you better say the same things. You see old photos of me? Oh, wow, I don't remember him being so chubby. Anyway. Okay, cool. That was for me just to calm my nerves. Thank you for bearing with that. So thank yous. I'm going to start off by thanking God for my father in our lives. And I just want to share just like a short little thing. I didn't want to do a eulogy, but I'm going to share something while I'm up here, and then if I don't get through it, then I'll just go to the thank yous. But even Chanel asked me, like, do we have little things that we can put here, like little things to remember him by? And unless I just brought a bunch of files with spreadsheets and SARS documents and stuff, But that's pretty much what you guys remember him by. And he did serve here and everywhere else. So I decided not to bring all of that. But yeah, if I can just sort of, humor me for a little bit, then I'll just sort of recall a story. It's not doesn't put me in a very good light, but it just also like shows the person he was. So, it was also, it was probably my bachelor's party, to be honest. So a lot of alcohol and stuff involved. And not a wonderful time in my life, but it's like, my dad was there. I tried to act like good boy when I was with them. And then when I was not with the family, then, but now bachelor's party, the family sort of invited to that. Anyway, so the day afterwards, my dad just like gently approached me and said, listen, he assumes I don't even realize how much I swear, but it's like, it's descriptive language, it's emotional language, it's like every sentence just said this, had these words come out, but the way he handled it, the way he just, like, on his own, gently came up to me the next day and said, listen, you probably don't even realize that you swear as much as you do, but perhaps just, keep an eye on it. And it's the way he approached me and, like, what he said, it's always stuck with me. It's like, hopefully hopefully it shows in my life since then. but just the gentle approach and how we how we approach things like that. It was I just want to just see where I'm supposed to be. Okay, and then there was something which I actually heard last week. I was at my own church service, and there was a comment made about how one of the people were. Oh no, this is actually just not going to help. Okay. It was a comment made about how the church is a body, and when you lose a piece of the body, there is a hole to be filled. And yeah, you mentioned that he's like still sort of on one of the things, and the comment was actually made about this funeral that this guy went to, and actually mentioned that that yes, you can't pray for Alan anymore. We can't. He's gone. He's graduated. We can pray for us that are left behind, and like the body that's now has this hole that needs to get filled. And it was a role that needs to get filled. And so we're gonna so we just pray for that. Sorry, I'm just. So I'm actually going to, well, when I wrote this down, I thought it was going to take a lot longer, but anyway, I'm going to pray for us all quickly, and I did write this down word for word so that I don't mess it up. So the prayer at least was written this morning when I was sort of like a bit more in advance. So I'm going to pray quickly. Excuse me if it sounds like it's reading, because it is, but it was like genuinely prayed this morning from the heart. So where are we at? Okay. Lord, we thank you for Alan, and we thank you for the lives he touched. And Lord, we thank you for every person in each of our lives, those that we are able to influence and those that influence us. Holy Spirit, please give us the courage to be influencers for good. Lord, we as a family have lost a father, a husband, and a grandpa. But we also think about Para Wesley Methodist Church that have lost a member of their body. And Lord, I pray that you send somebody to fill that gap in this body and make them whole again. Lord, be with each one of us as we leave here today and influence others. Amen. Okay, oh, that sounded very red, eh? But anyway, sorry about that. I was from the heart earlier on. I was all to God. God knows where I'm coming from. So yeah. Okay, so now the official thank yous. Thank you to Jenny for the service, and Derek for the music, and Grant, who's able to, like, at least share this with more than just us that could be here today, that everywhere from everyone from anywhere is able to at least share this moment with us. And I thank my buddies there, Soldiers for Jesus, for helping with the pamphlets, and especially Daphne and Chanel that sort of put a lot of effort into the layout and design and all the other stuff. Some of which was only sort of like edited again last night, so thanks, guys. Ingrid, thank you for the flowers. Esme and Solnita for the tea and eats afterwards. So yes, there are tea and eats afterwards. And all the ladies that helped providing that. And then a special thank you for Eagle Eye. Yeah, as you guys heard, my dad was retrenched a while at some point, and then there were lots of ups and downs. But the last bit of his career before retiring, if somebody gave him a chance, you guys gave him saw this old guy, and you gave him an opportunity, and Yeah, I don't know, well, there was a 10 years or, I don't know, it seems like 10 years or a bit more, a bit less, but I mean, around about there. And I want to thank you. He spoke about you guys as family. We still laugh about even the office staff when it's crunch time, everybody's on the production line and they're building these little, I don't know, spikes and stuff that you guys put together. It's like your company really is like a little family, and thank you for making him part of yours. So, yeah. And then I'm going to just, I don't know if anybody's watching this, but I'm going to thank our church. Ingrid and I belong to Joshua Generation Church, and just for their support and stuff on their side of this. I'm horrible at admin and stuff, so this week's been a bit of a challenge mentally to try and get everything sorted out, and they sort of provided us with some extra help. So, yeah, I just want to thank you for that. And, yeah, this list seems very short, so... From me as a son, from my mom as a wife, and so on. I'd like to thank all of you that were involved in his life, and whoever the camera is, you guys too. So let's remember to influence others for the good. Amen.
Thank you, Stephen. It helps all of us to grieve when somebody is willing to come and stand up and do it. So thank you. We all are there with you, Stephen. Right, we are going to sing, then we have the very short prayer, and then we go to tea. Okay. So if we could stand and sing together, God be with you till we meet again.
Thank you.
just if you could stay standing. And just there's one last message, two last messages from Jackie Rodger in Scotland. Okay, so Stephen, when you said far away, Jackie's still cheap, better say it. And just before we get serious, P.S., my favorite memory of Uncle Alan is the time Nick and Stephen put aftershave in the kettle. Instead of getting cross, Alan just roared with laughter and said, "You watch out, I'll get you back." So that is Jackie having the last words there. Right, and I'm going to have the very last words. Let us pray. Merciful God, you have made us all and given your Son for our redemption. We commend our brother Alan to your perfect mercy and wisdom, for in you alone we put our trust. Amen. Just to say there is tea afterwards, to say that the family is grateful to Graham and to anybody else that they forgot to mention. They really do care and they will think about you later. But thank you all for being involved in this service. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. I think as a family we'd like to leave first and then the congregation can follow. And Grant's going to play something on the screen for us.
Day goes by that I don't see you. You
You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. The only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now.